My God, man. Do you know what this means? This ghetto's gonna be turned upside down, I tell you. Upside down. If you get on his bad side, brother, you're done for. Now, it's only a matter of time before he finds out. And when he does, no matter where he is, get ready, gentlemen, because hell's a coming. Hell's a coming. Hell's a coming. Hell's a coming.
You think you're the best. I hope you are. A Gundamn mobile suit is a fully articulated, fully equipped machine, armed with the most sophisticated weaponry known to man. To be a complete Gundamn pilot, you must train on both Gundamn systems. Believe me, gentlemen, to beat the best, you have to be the best.
In a world where podcasting is king, you are listening to Gundamn at MAHQ.
End of discussion! Debate is over, you will write a formal apology.
I will what?
A formal apology! You will kowtow, you will step and fetch.
Frank, if you think you can
get used to it, it's the way of the world! If you're so hot on discipline, then Gundamn it, start by accepting mine. Because contrary to popular opinion, I'm the head in charge.
Come on, let's get something to eat.
You really think you're bad, don't you?
Welcome back, everybody, to Gundamn at MAHQ. This is episode 290. I'm one of your hosts, Chris, and I'm joined by Soulbro. Say hello, Soulbro.
Man, oh shit! Is the cake is back, fellas, and so is Star Trek Discovery, man. Show over, man. I'll see you guys. Good night.
Okay, good show. See you later.
Peace.
If you're wondering why Neo is not introducing the episode, he's a little bit late, so he's going to join us soon. We have a good episode queued up for you tonight. We have an interview with Stephen Hero and PMCTrilogy, the hosts of the mecha-themed podcast Giant Robot FM. Say hello, gentlemen.
Hello, hello.
Hello.
We're glad to have you, and before we get to this discussion, we are going to do some Neo's news, and it just so happens that Neo has joined.
Holy
welcome
shit.
To the show, Neo.
Hey, hold on.
Before Neo speaks, Chris, your mic switched to like a speaker mic or something like that. I'm not sure what, but if we can hear you just fine. It just sounds like you're on speakerphone. So I don't know if
It was the mic was actually like literally pushed back a little bit on my headset.
Oh fuck. Well,
so it was distant. Oh. It was away from my head.
Oh, no, cool. That works. it's nice when the answers are simple. But Neo, welcome, sir.
Yeah, welcome. Sorry about that. Things just got in the way there. just give me a second here.
Since you're coming on board, I already had some of your news queued up. You want me to just handle that while you get settled in?
Yeah, that's fine. Go ahead and do it, Chris. Yeah, that's fine. Because I'm trying to get up to date on that, and probably I'm sure the people would like to here's somebody different for once. So,
all right, so ahead. I'm going to saunter over to the Larry King Memorial News Desk for some Neo's listener submitted news, which you can always submit more topics in the Neo's News listener submission thread in the Gundamn section of the Mechatalk forums. So our first one comes from listener MCT Dread, who has a link to Crunchyroll.com about how the Gundam Steed Freedom movie is screening in the U.S. in early May, finally, after it's played in so many other parts of the world. So the long and the short of it is that on May 7th, it's going to be screening subbed, and on May 8th, it's going to be dubbed. And I'm presuming that for the returning characters, this is the new dub cast for Right Stuff's redubs of Seed and Destiny HD, probably not the old cast, because that wouldn't make any sense. So you can get your tickets on Fandango. It's one of those Fathom events. I already have my tickets ordered and going to see it with good old General Hate. So it's going to be a good experience. Oh, yeah. So May 7th and 8th, mark it on your calendars. Our next one also comes from MCT Dread, who has a link to KyotoNews.net about the farewell ceremony for the Moving Gundam in Yokohama. I watched the live stream of this. It was a very interesting event. You should check it out on YouTube. They had a speech from Tamino, was there dressed in a goofy Gundam jacket and with his little G-Reco hat that he's been wearing for a couple of years. And they had this really impressive fireworks and illuminated drone light show. So you could see next to the statue the drones making up all these images from Mobile Suit Gundam. Amaru and Char facing off in their pilot suits from the finale. You could see the Zaku. They did the last shooting. And then they transitioned and did the Ariel and Miorin and Suleta. And they also showed the Freedom with Kira and Lakus, you know, while playing songs from those respective shows. And it was really interesting. And they had Toru Furuya doing the voice of an Amuro AI in the computer and talking about people cooperating to bring peace in the future. And, you know, it was a very nice send-off, although... You know, I thought it curious that they did this on Sunday, March 31st, when, at the time of we're recording this stream, Sunday, March 7th is the 45th anniversary of Gundam. So it kind of seems like that would have been the better time to do it. But, you know, I don't know what the logistics were there.
Well, and you forget, Chris, did you mention the Char and Amuro kiss?
Yes,
their thing. Okay, yeah,
because yes, they did. Have everybody, that.
Yeah, everybody's
sure did. Crazy.
Yeah.
So next up, we have not one, not two, not three, but four new submissions. Rodimus 76. So I'm just gonna run through these real quickly. First up, a Robo Apocalypse news alert: police robot dog shot during standoff in Massachusetts. That's from NBC News.
Wow.
Next we have from CBR.com, Transformers and TMNT crossover with Ghostbusters, because 80s nostalgia is everything and nothing has any meaning.
Why not? Because why not, right?
Yeah. Third up we have from Tformers.com, Transformers, music from the original animated series, vinyl LPs are coming out.
Oh.
And finally, from GeekTyrant.com, Adam Wingard says his Thundercats movie will 100% honor the 80s series.
Man, it's a lot of Thundercats on, man. The comic book just rebooted, so that's super cool. Going into the Transformers with Ghostbusters and TMNT, I've never seen them crossover with TMNT, but there's a comic book crossover on IDW between Ghostbusters and Transformers, and that's been out for a few years, so I think this the Ecto-1 becomes a Transformer, and they're re-releasing it.
It does.
So that's super cool. They're re-releasing it, so that's not bad.
And our next piece comes from MCT Dread. This one's from ANN. Hideaki Anno leads Space Battleship Yamato Anime 50th Anniversary Project. That's going to be interesting and I'm sure also weird and existential and maybe some ennui.
It may be disgusting too, so.
You never know. You never know. That's the end of the submitted topics. I'm going to throw out a couple more. We got news recently that Kodansha USA has licensed the Mobile Suit Gundam The Origin MSD Kukurus Doan's Island manga. Now, this is not to be confused with the movie, because although they both feature Kukurus Doan, they are not at all the same story, and this manga is a tie-in with the Mobile Suit Discovery kind of MSV line that was released alongside the Origin OVA. So I know that sounds very confusing, because of course it is, and I'm not sure why we would get this manga, but you know, I'm never going to be mad about more officially released Gundam manga in America.
Same here.
Yeah.
And you know, just one bit of you know, backpatting news. This week that we're recording is the 24th anniversary of MAHQ. So you know, we did it for another year, folks.
Hell yeah, man! Holy shit! It's a quick 24 years, man. So quick.
Well, congratulations. Sure don't feel like it sometimes.
Yeah, sometimes. Yeah. I second that sentiment, but congratulations, man. That's an amazing feat, man. There's a lot of websites. What's that?
24 years and one unplanned website makeover that was promised it would never happen, but happened. So.
And on the 7th anniversaries, we have some Gundam anniversaries this month. So as I mentioned before, we have coming up in a few days the 45th anniversary of Mobile Suit Gundam. And, you know, I can remember when the 20th anniversary was a big deal, because that's how old I am.
Yeah, absolutely.
We also have the 30th anniversary of G Gundam.
Wow.
And the 20-something anniversaries also for Wing and X. So congratulations to all of those series. And Solbro, did you want to gas up the Straight Talk Express to discuss that topic you mentioned, or leave that for another time?
Hold on 1 second. There's one news article you forgot to do, Chris, on the Neo's Listeners for News Article thread. And it's coming from MCT Dread.
Oh my lord!
It's from Deadline.com. It's the link to what a lot of people are saying is early favorite for Best Picture.
I'm sure about it.
Bad Boys for Life. The trailer's been released. Yes. They're back. The boys are back.
They are indeed. It's not Bad Boys for Life. That movie already came out.
Bad Boys Ride or Die.
I think they
Ride or Die. That's
they,
right.
They
that's
so
right.
wasted. Right. They wasted that fucking title on the third movie. What were they thinking? Anyway,
they didn't think there was going to be a four.
It should be. It should be four bad, four boys.
Yes.
Well, this is the fourth installment in the BBCU, the Bad Boys Cinematic Universe.
Well, I'm sure. I'm sure Dominic Toretto's going to show up next.
There you go.
But you can cross over to any other franchise when you've got family.
Yes,
indeed. Exactly.
Indeed.
And you take life a quarter mile at a time. So, yeah.
Man.
Thank you, Mix, for correcting my oversight there.
No, not oversight. Just think of me as the striker. You know, like in the fighting games, I'm the striker in this.
Oh boy.
This episode. New striker.
We KOF now. I see you.
Yep, new striker.
Well, Solberg, did you want to briefly mention that topic, or leave it for another time?
I will leave it for another time. What I will do is I'll point out a few things. Rodimus 76 donated or came up with a lot of the imagery you're going to see tonight. So shout outs to him. That's Rudy, of course. Also, one of our resident news hounds. So Rudy, as always, man, thank you so much for contributing some of the art for tonight's display for the stream. If you guys are having any trouble watching on YouTube, you can also go to twitch.tv/fightersready, where there's a backup stream there. I will be uploading the local recording for this stream once I'm done. I don't know why I'm having upload issues, but apparently I am. So there's frame rate droppage, but it seems to be holding up at least to some degree. But on YouTube, I'll upload the unfettered version of the video after the show. So you guys will see that up there. My apologies. Yo, shout out to Rudy. I see you in the chat. The other thing I wanted to mention is a little bit of cleanup from last episode. You guys remember we talked about the year 1984 and all the Mecha and sci-fi shows, movies, books, and stuff that came out that year. Well, there were two significant ones that we left off the list, and I'm just going to touch upon them really quick. One of them is a favorite of a lot of people because they grew up in the 1980s and saw this show as Saber Rider and the Star Sheriffs. It's a show called Bismarck, animated series. It came on in Japan and it came to the United States, I believe, the very next year. It was a cool show. I never got the chance to see when I was growing up, but I've seen clips ever since, and I thought that was cool that it came out in 84. And I know that someone over in Germany is going to have my throat when he finds out we fucking forgot to mention it. So there you go. That's number one. Number two, though, is a little bit more personal. It's a show called Video Warrior Lazarian. It came out in, of course, 84. And I've never seen this show at all, but when finding out, thanks to Sho, by the way, you guys, a lot of you guys know Shoji Romero. Check out his stream at twitch.tv/Shoji Romero. He was on the stream with me when I was streaming on last Saturday night, and we were going over what we talked about in the episode for Gundam, and we were looking at the list, and he noticed that we were missing two animes that were mecha animes that we didn't talk about. One of them was Bismarck, the other one was this one. And when I pulled up the Wikipedia for this, it looked instantly familiar. I don't know if Enron's watching, but if Enron runs this back, about a year ago, he and I were trying to figure out what show this was, because in 1984, when I was a kid, my dad was stationed in Japan, because he was in the Navy, and I asked him, like a dumbass, could you please try to find Optimus Prime for me, not knowing about Diaclone, not knowing about his name being Convoy, when he was over there, but he said he'd do his best to try to find him. When he got back, he brought back something completely different, and it was a toy based on this show, and I believe I have a picture here. There we go. This is it on eBay, but I had no idea what this shit was in 1984, but I thought it was cool, and I had it for at least a good couple of years, and then, you know, it eventually got destroyed as kids fucked the toys up. But after that, I just continued to wonder, what was this from? And then, just by accident, I stumbled upon it during that night. And it looks, it's a show that features, it seems like Studio Perot's attempt at Mobile Suit Gundam, not Studio Perot, but the animation studio that worked on this, TBS's, or Toei Animation's attempt at Mobile Suit Gundam. It actually features the voices of Toru Furui. I always have a hard time saying his last name. But he is the voice, of course, Amuro in Mobile Suit Gundam. And then Keiko Han is the voice of the lead woman in that, and she played Lala Soon in Mobile Suit Gundam. And if you watch the intro, it's very 80s, but very cool looking. So maybe we'll put this in the slate of shows to review in the future. But I love this. I finally love to connect with the actual show side of things and complete the circle. So that's what I wanted to bring up. And let's see. Yazzie says, yes, it came out recently, I believe. It was announced last year. Wow, that's cool. It got licensed by Discotech? Well, that's getting picked up. I don't know.
They license everything, you know. You know, if you're waiting for Space Warrior Linguini, they got that one queued up too.
Fuck yeah, dude, man! I definitely want to own this just to complete the just to finish the fight, as Master Chief would say. But just found it to be a little neat thing. That is basically my rant. So thank you guys for entertaining that. I've seen this Mecha Super Robot Wars Z and such. Mecha-san says shout out to Mecha-san. It's just nice to get in contact with that. Shout out to Sho for kind of guiding me along the way. So that's what's up. Back to you guys.
Well, thank you for that. And, you know, for Steven, our discussion of 1984 stuff in the year 2024, we totally ripped up off from Retronauts No Shame.
Hell yeah.
No shame. Hats off.
Just adapted for Mecha and sci-fi.
Stolen.
yes. You know... It's the sincerest form of flattery. So we're going to move on to our main discussion right now, which is an interview with Stephen Hero and PMC Trilogy, the hosts of the Giant Robot FM podcast, which you can find on your favorite podcatcher app. And you can also check out their Patreon if you want to sign up for all of the bonuses that comes with supporting their show. So whenever we do an interview with someone, I always like to establish sort of a baseline of context. So given that we all talk about Mecha, can you both tell us what's your origin story with mecha anime or mecha in general? What hooked you into the franchise, well, into the genre, and at what age?
I think PMC and I both have the basic millennial answer, and that's Gundam Wing when we were like in our early teens, and then that fandom just morphed from there as we grew older. I know that Gundam Wing was probably the first mecha I was exposed to as a, what, how old was I? Like around 11, 12 years old. And then from there, I was really captivated by the aesthetics of these giant robots. So I moved on to Eva, which really hit like a core aspect of who Stephen Hero is at an impressionable young age. So that show is like burned into my psyche as part of my marrow. But then I followed like the like a slate of Adult Swim and Toonami programming as it relates to mecha. So I watched OFMS Team from there. This also applied to games. So I played like Front Mission, Zone of the Enders. I wish I had some really oddball choices to throw y'all's way, but I really have like the basic like suburban teenage answer here.
There's nothing wrong with coming into it the way you did. Like, you know, obviously anime 24 years ago was a very different thing in terms of like discoverability and accessibility.
Steven, I'm curious because I obviously we both share Wing, and that is, I think, definitely the common point there. So growing up, I had an older brother, so I'm a baby from 1988. And so my older brother is 9 years older than me. And so, of course, what did that mean? That meant I got lots of hand-me-down Transformers, right? There are lots of VHS cassettes with Transformers lying around.
Oh, yeah.
So I think between that and then also, and this is something, actually, I'm curious to see if Steven was into this, because I also would have been the right age for that first wave of Power Rangers hitting in like 94, 95. And I was super into that. I had all the Zords and everything. And maybe I didn't quite identify it as mecha, but there's certainly a relationship there, I think, pretty safe to say. That. And between those two things, I would say they really primed me for Wing, for, you know, and then turning around, getting Xenogears, Armored Core, et cetera.
Yeah, I didn't watch much Transformers, the 80s show, when I was young, like in single digits. I did watch my fair share of Beast Wars, though. But I don't know if that, like, activated the sicko mecha part of my brain as, like, a 7-year-old.
Beast Wars doesn't activate something? I'm not sure I understand that, see. I mean, I must have watched the 86 Transformers movie so many times. Like, and it's still, that's one of those films that's burned into my brain.
Oh, yeah.
I was one of those 6-year-olds who cried in the theater when Optimus died.
Yes! Yes!
Yeah, it's funny, because obviously I'm too young to have had that experience, and instead I think, you know, finally of the Power Rangers movie, like seeing like a 9 a.m. matinee on like a rainy day or something. And that was the real theater experience.
Yeah, that's one of the few instances where my Orson Welles fandom and my mecha fandom become conjoined.
Who would have thought it was such a crossover?
Orson Welles!
Oh my gosh.
So, you know, if, you know, Wing was what drew you both in, what is it that, like, solidified you in mecha fandom and put you on the trajectory to becoming podcast hosts? You know, what was like sort of what really gelled for you about the genre? And it could be, you know, one series or a couple of series or games or whatever.
It was probably Eva and Xenogears as like a very impressionable 13-year-old. But I phased out of anime in my 20s. I was too pretentious for that as like a film studies major, so I only came back to anime in my later 20s and 30s. Really, as a means to like reconnect with high school friends, because PMC and I, you know, went our separate ways in our mid-20s, so we're childhood friends. And then I was really itching for like a way to relive the glory days of just chilling in your friend's basement. So eventually I pitched PMC on a podcast idea, and then it morphed from there.
The film school kind of screwed you up there, because it made you think that, you know, animated stuff is not as good or, you know, as important as other things.
True. To be fair, though, I never was interested in the production side. So I, you know, a pretentious liberal arts major, lit major, history major, and then film studies, which is basically just another literature class.
With moving pictures.
Yeah. Yeah, it's funny because that's definitely a big part of it was that, you know, the works like Wing, like Xenogears, were sort of things that, you know, that I guess did bring us together and were foundational in the podcast. Like, I know for me, it's weird thinking about because I don't know what kept me coming back to it. This has come up on the podcast a few times where, like, for example, we just finished Big O 2, right? That episode, I literally hit upload on that episode like a few hours ago, the final of our Big O 2 coverage. Oh, and I
tasty
know
tomatoes.
The time was right. but I know I watched that in like 2011 for some reason. Like I was, you know, I was just out of college. I was, you know, I guess making use of my free time, and I was going back. I watched Zeta for the first time, watched Big O 2 for the first time, and I can't say why. I can't say that at that point we were. I don't know. Obviously, y'all are working on the website, but you know, I didn't have any sort of grand plan to, you know, get into streaming video games or uploading podcasts or anything. But yeah, I just kept coming back to it. You know, some of that nostalgia, but some of that also that I did find the the material interesting and sort of like tactile in a way. The thing that really I talk about interfaces all the time. I'm engineering guy by background, and I love that in mecha media, even, you know, the super robot stuff, there's always this focus on how the person interacts with it and then how the mecha interacts with its environment. And that's true of BattleTech, and that's true of of giant Robo.
Yeah.
Yeah, PMC, if you want to impress everyone with your mecha credentials, just talk about your extensive reading list of BattleTech novels.
I've been, some generous listener of our podcast, I should say generous, they really burdened me with knowledge, pointed out to me that like Catalyst Game Labs had like a huge sale on BattleTech books, and I went and bought like 60 ebooks for like, it was like 10 or 15 bucks. And for like a year now, I've probably read 20 or 25. I finished one last night. I'm going to start another one tonight. And it's like, I can't help myself.
Yeah, I have a friend who he spent the last couple of years going through like 30 plus books or something of Warhammer 40K, Horus Heresy. And it's like a journey that I never thought that he would complete. And he finally did. And it's like that. You took on quite a burden there, sir.
I gotta say shout outs to Vanguard Bandits. I see Vanguard Bandits from Yazzie there in the chat. I didn't play that as a kid, but I did stream that a few years ago and it was a good time.
Yeah, my physical copy of Vanguard Bandits is in like arm's length for me.
That's an awesome game, man, for real. Man.
That's a good one, yeah.
So while we're on the subject of origin points, for a reminder to our listeners and, you know, for our guests, we might as well share ours briefly. So the turbo version of mine was, as a small child in the 80s, I was very heavily into the Transformers and to a lesser extent discount Transformers, aka GoBots.
Oh boy.
As well as Ultron. Then I kind of fell off of that for a while, and in the 90s, I got really into Exo Squad, and I was playing games like Cybernator, aka Assault Suits Vulcan, and not really understanding what the anime context of any of that was, which is covered in an editorial I wrote on MHQ last year. You can find that on the website. And then once I started really getting into anime, knowing that it was actually anime and from Japan, you know, I dove into stuff like Macross 2, Macross Plus, Evangelion, the MSG movie trilogy, Gundam 0080, and I think those last two are really what helped, like, seal me onto the path that I am still on today.
Oh, yeah.
So, Neo and Sobro, what were your origin stories, just to get us all on the same page?
Neo, you
want to go? I was bitten by a radioactive mecha.
Yes.
Radioactive Transformer. Stuff.
Was it the spider from Wild Wild West, the bitch?
John Gruber's favorite mecha.
Woo!
Yeah.
Terrible. PMC, we got to cover that on the podcast. We're going to invite Kevin Smith on.
We've been joking about it for years.
That's what's up.
I need to repost that on Mecha Day. It's been like 3 years since I last posted it.
Yes.
No, but mine's pretty similar as Chris's. You know, growing up in similar age. Yeah, Transformers, Robotech. You know, I was watching a lot, loved Battle of the Planets, loved Transor Z and all these old things that used to show on all those independent stations in South Florida when I lived down there. And I used to go to this comic book store, and the guy there used to have, like, he had a Char figurine, and he started having some Mecha, you know, some old, I get probably, I mean, I wish I had those now. They're probably Gunpla, they're worth some money. I didn't know what they were at the time. And, you know, just kind of got into it. And then, you know, what it happens, Toonami happens. And it sounds like with all of us now, like, Gundam Wing is like the gateway drug. Like, if you want your friends to get into Mecha, show them Gundam Wing, no matter what age they're from. And yeah, just kind of went from there, met up with Soulbro when I was still living in Florida. And, you know, we just started going back and forth on this stuff, and then started the podcast. And Chris joined us, like, I think 2 or 3 episodes later. We thought we were in trouble because we used to rip everything off his off his website. So we thought we were going to get, like, a cease and desist. Like, you guys are, you're terrible. We don't watch you. You know, don't do this. And yeah, so it's been that way ever since. And yeah, so I think what just attracts me is, you know, of course, just the awesomeness of a lot of a giant machinery doing amazing things. But, you know, we've seen that there's been some just great storylines. And, you know, it's nice to see as people from our generation seeing that, you know, anime in general, even Mecha anime, is so well accepted now. I mean, I played sports in college, and I was like one of the few people that would go to, when I was in college, I would go to the Japanimation night at the you know, the school theater, and see, like, Ghost of the Shell and stuff. And now I see, like, you know, NFL players wearing, like, in the Naruto shirt. So it's a great thing to see. And but yeah, that's basically where we're at now. And yeah, so bro,
man. I'm old as dust. I was born in 77, so I was exposed to anime over in when we lived in Puerto Rico in, like, 79, but my first brush with the Mecha anime was 84, much like Chris and Neo. We watched Transor Z, which is Mugenzer Z, of course.
Yeah.
Of course, Voltron and Mighty Orbots. Oh, yeah. Which is not technically anime, but it might as well be. And then, of course, the very next year, Robotech aired in 1985. I was 8 years old. It changed my life. You know, I of course, abhor Harmony Gold. I got to state that. but man,
we all do.
Between,
is this the ritual, like, 2 minutes of hate of Harmony Gold?
Oh yes, of course. But of course, but I will postpone that for the time being. I will say that I grew up with the novels, and of course the anime and the comics and all that stuff, and role-playing games. A book that I treasure is called Robotech Art 1, which is pretty much my Bible for that series. But that book taught me what anime was. There's a very important section at the very back that breaks down Japanese animation, legendary animes that came before Macross. You know, it was Crusher Joe, of course, Yamato, and all the other series that inspired what we watch today. And then, of course, coming up in the 90s, Mecha anime started leaking to me. I didn't really get into Gundam until I wouldn't say got into Gundam, but my first brush with it was in high school when someone lent me a tape of the first couple episodes of 0083, subtitled. It was, you know, fan sub from Jayco. But then years later, of course, Toonami would air Gundam Wing, and that was definitely a seminal moment. And then right after that, they would air Mobile Suit Gundam, and I'd been dying to see that show for ages. And then shortly after that, Neo, as Neo said, I met Neo, and he's the reason why I got to see Gundam Seed, because he already was collecting the old DVDs, and then we started exchanging our DVD collections. We started loaning each other our stuff.
Well,
and
then, well, I was watching the Raws first. I'd download them. The old thing of where you would, it sounds so dated now. And like, I'm not, it's funny because we always joke because people are like, oh, it's so much better when you could do all this stuff. And instead of getting, like, the same day subtitle worldwide release, where it was like, you'd get the Raw, you'd hope the Raw was there Sunday night, and then you'd watch it. And you didn't know what anything was going on because you can't speak the language. And then you're like, okay. And then, you know, maybe the next day or two, you get, like, one of the first, like, rough you know, subtitles.
Speed subs.
Yeah, speed subs and all that. So, and then sometimes you get shit out of luck because one of them would go out a bit, you know, they'd stop doing it or something like that.
Oh, yeah.
But yeah, it's, yeah, I definitely, we are not of those people. It's like, oh yeah, when it was such a horrible thing to get any of this crap. No, I enjoy it now. But yeah. That was some crazy, that was dedication there. I look back, I'm like, why, man, I sat there and I watched that shit when it was, I didn't even know what they were saying.
Raw dog, man. We all did it, man, because you didn't know when the sub was coming out. You didn't, but that's how far we've come. That's how we've come a long way from bootleg tapes to taping off of television to the DVDs and lucky for those who are lucky enough to have Laserdisc. Holy shit, man, I wish I had a player back in the day. But yeah, man, that's my story in brief. About how I got into mecha anime, I'm pretty much.
All right.
It's my favorite genre of anime, and might be of all time, to be honest.
In the chat, Fred says, "Nah, nothing touches the feeling of downloading RAWs and figure out how to apply SRT files to play alongside the video."
Oh my god! Yeah.
The hunt for SRT files to apply to RAW was definitely something back in those days.
And what was the other thing where you have to go get like the what was that old video or that old video player that you would have to find? Not the VLC, but the other. Yeah.
A real like player?
Some of them weren't encoded. Yeah, players. They weren't encoded. Oh. You're like, oh crap, I gotta find the real player. And then you're like, oh, I need the player. Yeah, I need the codex. Like searching online for the codex. But
oh Jesus.
Man. So in terms of podcasting, you know, we've obviously been yammering on since 2007, but for PMC and Steven, what made you all want to turn your interest into mecha anime into a mecha podcast?
Good question. So in addition, so originally there was a period in my life where you name drop Retronauts before. Retronauts is one of my favorite podcasts. Have been listening since 2006, since the 1UP days. In addition to Retronauts, there were like 3 to 5 other podcasts I would religiously listen to, you know, weekly for about like 3 years. And the idea of a podcast kept percolating in my mind. So you know how people like make up fake band names with no intention of actually starting the band, but they like to start, you know, come up with names. I would come up with fun names for podcasts. And I thought I hit gold. I was walking through a park one day. I thought I hit gold because I came up with Just Communicating as a Gundam Wing podcast. And which is still a banger name. It's good.
Yeah, that is good. I do like that.
And anyone could take it. I've been talking about Just Communicating since we started podcasting. And there is a, more so than any other Gundam show, even like the Tomino UC stuff, there have been more podcasts dedicated to discussing Gundam Wing on an episode by episode basis than anything else. I kept like a running count for I've lost count recently, but there's probably at least 2 dozen podcasts dedicated to Gundam Wing over the last 12 years.
Wow. Yeah, it's like the godfather of mecha. I mean, like the Godfather movie, it's the same one. Like everybody loves this thing. I mean,
it speaks to its entrenched in position in American fandom, at least for like millennials and above.
Yes.
Yeah, it does. Mm-hmm. I mean, it really does.
I know we covered it twice on the show. The first time we did it was part of the Gundam Roundup way back in the early episodes of the series. And then
I rewatched it like 2 years ago.
Yeah,
like,
and you and I rewatched it together on stream live. Yeah, I believe we did a revisit. It was during the time that Chris was away from the show. We revisited Gundam Wing and talked about it again on the podcast. So we covered at least twice on this. But yeah.
Can't get away from it.
And I did a full re-review of the entire series probably about a decade ago. So
I mean,
it's got a lot of inspiration by a lot of people.
It's a solid show. I mean, it's full of tropes and all these other things. And parts of it can be kind of cheesy and weird and dumb. But I mean, it's straight up entertainment. Like, I always felt entertained.
Space Queen Emily once said on Twitter, I'll never forget this, she's completely right, that if Gundam Wing were as good as talking about Gundam Wing is, we'd live in a utopia.
Hell yeah, we would.
I have a soft spot for Gundam Wing.
I do too.
Well, I think all of us do. Well, I mean, quick question. I know, Chris, you got some questions, but just came to my mind. Would Gundam Wing be a good, real, live action anime series to adapt? I mean, I feel in some ways, if you're going to do any of the Gundam shows, that might be the best one that might have the most cross market appeal. I mean, you're always going to get, like, with the UC stuff, the true, like, you know, war people and strategy people and stuff like that. But I honestly think if you did a live action Gundam Wing in the spirit of the show, I think it would be pretty, pretty damn popular.
It could make a banger, like, CW show.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah, you could, yeah.
You get some Korean. You get
some series with a K-pop band.
You get a K-pop band. That's what I was talking about right there. Yes. Yes. License to Free Money.
Hey, I'll watch it.
You know, you look back at Wing, and it's funny that, like, Bandai stumbled upon such a huge hit with Wing all the way back in the year 2000, because it's, you know, this year is also the... Last month was the 24th anniversary of the debut of Wing in America, and they had no idea what they had on their hands because, you know, I remember they were out there releasing, at literally the same time as Wing, the Dreamcast game Rise from the Ashes, you know, the one-year war side story.
Yep.
And I remember people on forums being like, what the fuck is a Zaku? What is Zeon? Where's Hero in this game? Where's Duo? I don't know what the Federation is. And it's just like, oh, Bandai, what are you doing? What are you doing? And then, you know, instead of the natural follow-up to Wing to keep the momentum going, which should have been X, they're like, oh, let's do MSG because MSG's big in Japan, so it should be big here too.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, man, you guys, you messed it up just as you were making a strong start out of the gate.
It took a while to figure
it out. Really is so weird to think about those two things arriving at the same time, because I've gone back and played that Dreamcast game since. I've done some speed runs of it, and it's like, it's a neat thing, but, like, yeah, not the thing to have in the market at the same time as Gundam Wing.
Oh yeah, if you're thinking you've got the mindset of Gundam Wing and you're like, oh, I want to see what more in there, it's like, that is not the stuff to get into.
Like, honestly, you know, they had on the Super Famicom at the time of Wing's release, there was a game called fighting game called Endless Duel, mm-hmm. that became very popular in emulation circles, and of course it's been fan translated, and it's like, you could have done a very quick and dirty port of that to PlayStation 1 and gotten some decent cash for that rather than putting out, you know, Rise from the Ashes on the Dreamcast.
Yeah. Did we ever get, because I know we got it in Japan, but Federation versus Zeon DX, did that come out here in the States on the Dreamcast?
I think on PS2.
PS2.
On PS2, yeah. We'll
get my wires crossed. But
we never got the Dreamcast version.
Yeah,
I had to import it. Which I think is the nicer looking one.
Yeah, very much so.
So to open this up further, Neo and Soulbro, did you have any questions to throw at our illustrious guests?
I know I do. I'm
go ahead, Soulbro.
Go ahead.
Look, man, I'm sorry I have to do this to y'all. You're just going to have to take a nice long shower after this, scrub up, you know, cry a little. That's okay. But I have to ask, what is the worst mecha anime you have ever seen? I want to know if it's the same as ours. By all means, feel free to go for it.
Steven,
make it more interesting. It should be our least favorite thing we podcasted about.
Oh, please.
We did.
That's easy for me.
We did anime toilet once. So we used to have an ongoing thing called anime toilet. So we know the pain.
Longtime listeners will know I have a strong distaste and abhorrence for Code Geass R2. I think it's absolute trash.
No way!
Wow, you hate it.
Somewhere in the chat, Fred is celebrating right now. Our boy Frederick can't stand that show.
Now, note how I differentiate from season one, though. I think season one's a good time. R2 is an incomprehensible mess, I think.
Yo, wow.
Come on. Wait, you hate that all the things that were established in season one were just thrown out in the window? Man. It's like, they're not going to fly. They can't fly. And everybody's flying in season two. No, I agree with you there.
The series that went from having cool Votome-style fights to let's just do seed and have things flying around, shooting at each other over the ocean.
Oh, my God. Yeah, it's... That's bad.
What a mess.
Yeah. I see Ethan in chat bringing up Genlock, which we did cover. I always forget we covered Genlock. We covered the first season of Genlock maybe 4 years ago on our old podcast, and that's a memory hole I completely forgot existed.
Which is something we should definitely check out, because I know that Rooster Teeth just recently got the axe. Thank you, David Zaslav, you piece of shit. But but yeah, Genlock, I've been wanting to check it out because I know that the talent involved. Did you guys enjoy it, or was it terrible?
The first season is fine. I think, you know, if you're there for the talent, you're going to get some good performances and some fun stuff from, you know, from Michael B. Jordan and company. Mm-hmm. I've heard that season two is terrible. I only watched a video on season two. I've never watched season two myself.
Same.
Isn't that the worst, though? I don't know how many shows that we've been through. It's like season one is great, and then season two is just such garbage. I don't know what happens after that at that point. So
I can tell you why that happens. Most of the time is that they don't have the ending figured out when they start the show.
Yeah, or they, yeah, they, I think,
or they did, but then they threw it out in the case of R2, which, oh my, you know, God, we know was originally supposed to pick up right where season one left off, and then they moved to this different, more kid-friendly time slot, and Sunrise was like, no, let's kid this up and add, like, really garish mecha designs, and let's, you know, toss out that entire story you had in mind, Taniguchi.
Yeah.
I often put, when I've had people ask me about Code Geass, Chris, remember years ago you told me, remember the show Heroes that was on TV, and you told me just watch season one and don't go beyond that?
One of the best first.
That's what I kind of tell them with Code Geass. It's like, just watch season one and don't watch any of the other stuff after that, because it's a giant mess. It's like, yeah, I know you're probably going to be at the end. It's like, okay, kind of what happens, but you don't want to be disappointed, because it was really good. I think, I mean, season one was when that's the early stages of Gundam. I remember we were around that time, and I mean, it was a outstanding show. And I thought, I mean, even now, I think it's like, if Mr. HBO wanted a show like that, I would say that, you know.
Oh, David Zaslav?
I guess he is Mr. HBO, isn't unfortunately. He? So
it's got that prestige TV feel. It would totally work on something like HBO.
I think it would, yeah. Because if you have that grounded in reality type of mecha, I think, I mean, I've always thought that would be a good one.
But, you know, for all of its many faults, and R2 does have many faults, it has its moments, and I still like it more than Akito the Exiled, which is just,
oh god,
to me, an incomprehensible mess, just full of unnecessary characters and unnecessary things, and just like, why did this thing happen?
And what was
other than giving us creepy spider mecha?
And what was it, like 3 years of watching, of trying to get to watch four episodes or something like that? I don't know if it was that long, but
yeah, it took forever.
Like, yeah, I mean, it was like,
yeah, I enjoyed Akito the Exile so much that I reviewed the first episode in 2012, and I still haven't finished the series. So what does that tell you? I've had the Blu-ray sitting on my shelf for God knows how many years.
I should say, I haven't seen any of the OVAs. Like, I haven't seen Akito. I haven't seen the Nunnally Alice in Wonderland OVA. I haven't seen Resurrection. I do intend to watch Resurrection. I'm probably, before the new show starts, I think it's what, now it's airing on Disney Plus. I think I'm going to, yeah, I have the Blu-ray that's super out of print of the compilation films, and instead of selling that for like and pay my mortgage, I think I'm just going to watch the compilation films and watch Resurrection, and then jump into whatever it's called, not Zia the Recapture, whatever it's been renamed.
Rosé
to.
Of the Recapture.
Rosé. Yeah.
There you go.
Oh, Jesus.
Chief wine of the Recapture.
Yes.
Resurrection wasn't wasn't horrible, but it wasn't good. And not only, yeah, that one was just like, okay, whatever, you know.
Those little one-shot OVAs, they're kind of just inconsequential fluff. They don't really, you know, there's no harm that comes from watching them or not watching them. I thought Resurrection was enjoyable, and it kind of made up for some of R2's mistakes you know, undeserved endings that I did not enjoy. So, you know, it's an experience, and you know, it's like a lot of long-running series. Like, sometimes you just want to, like, immerse yourself back in that world of something that you enjoyed, and you're remembering more the thing that you enjoyed than like the current product that you're consuming. So it kind of falls into that mold.
Yeah.
If I had to pick on what's probably like, because we've generally been fortunate in that we've chosen to cover good things on Jarrett Robot FM. If I had to pick a worse one, it's probably, and I apologize if Zappaslave is still in chat because he had asked us to look into this.
Oh.
It's probably MS Igloo. We covered the first volume of it. Wow. And that was,
Nazis.
Yeah, it just, they really didn't want to talk about the war crimes that were going on just over there.
Hell yeah.
fucking awful.
Weird, right? My apologies, Zappa.
Are you excited about the Netflix? I guess it's somewhat in line.
Of Igloo 3.
It basically is Igloo 3. Yeah, but I just saw the recent trailer for that, and it looks, it's cool, but people are like bitching about it already. So it's gonna be a mixed bag. I know when it hits, but hopefully it's a little bit better than Igloo. We'll see.
Yeah, as a gun tank fanatic, I hate the Hodolfer. So down with Igloo.
Whoa, the rare Hodolfer hater.
Okay, wait. Can we talk about
whatever, the Hodolfer's way better than gun tank?
I'll tell you. Whoa, wow.
Who are you? How dare you, man? Original gun tank, RX-77. Oh, man.
Do we know about the most ridiculous Hodolfer fact? The thing that has to do with Code Fairy. Are we aware of this?
Oh, enlighten us, please.
Yes. Yes.
Okay. I'm sorry, that ruined me.
Yes, it's weird. It is definitely weird.
Yo, Ed in the chat saying gun tank gang rise up.
Yeah, man.
Yes.
Why so would you not be in a brightly colored half tank, half mobile suit thing that's got a canopy roof? I mean, that makes perfect sense in a battle.
Yo, I'll call my boy Norris the county.
Hey, and when he was in space, that to tell me that was not the best part. I mean, sometimes I know those compilation movies, people love them, but mm-hmm. The fact that I miss Gun Tank in space, that kind of bugs me.
Yeah, it bugs me. It's a shame.
I know that out of the Gundamn team that I played Code Fairy, but PMC, do you want to relate to us the sad story of the Hodolfer in Code Fairy?
Yeah, so a big part of a lot of the Igloo stories, and of course it's true in that one as well, is that you have somebody who's like really good at something, but it's not mobile suits. And turns out it's Gundam, so mobile suits are important. And so the Hodolfer pilot, heroically goes down in flames after, taking out a squad of stolen Zakus. And, I think they kind of have to, I forget if they bail or something. I have not actually played Code Fairy, so I have only read about this other part of it, which is that The Code Fairy team apparently shows up and gives this guy a proper big exclamation, big quotation marks on that burial at some point. And that's just like, please don't let
not exactly the Code Fairy team
reinter me.
So what happens is, the Code Fairy like level up their equipment because, they all start off kind of just using goose. And one of your team members is this, buxom teenage lass with glasses, and she's that character, and she's just a big old mecha nerd, and she is piloting a dome tropical test type, and she has done some research and has located the remains of the Hodolfer where it was destroyed. So she wants to go out on a mission to retrieve its cannon, which she does, and then attaches it to some like hover booster system of something else to then make kind of like sort of a ground-based version of Seed's meteor that she attaches to the back of her dome that kind of is like a big butt with a cannon on it.
Oh god.
And I think they did kind of like have a little scene at the end of that mission, because that mission involves you getting attacked by two Pale Rider variants, because of course we need to have even more Pale Riders. And after the end of that mission, it's like, oh, I'm so sad that this guy died, but thank you, sir, for the cannon that I'm going to use on this mecha or something like that. I don't remember. It's weird.
Yeah, that was
true story.
I knew that going into the podcast record, but like me and the guest intentionally concealed it from Steven.
Oh, wow.
Steven had to react live.
Yeah, it was quite shocking. Imagine dying on the battlefield, and that's your end point. Years later, you're interred and basically given a proper funeral by a bunch of Moe girls in a questionable Gundam game.
Yes, full of, you know, a bunch of, you know, weird sicko teams and war crimes teams, and it's a really weird game. I mean, I enjoy it, but like that story goes to some funky places at times. And the chat Mecha-san, yes, he notes it's a Gallup hover system. So yes, it's the Gallup hover system with the Dolphin cannon, and I think a bunch of missile launchers and like heat hawks strapped to the side, and then it's attached to the back of Mia's dome tropical test type, and she calls it the Dome Nomides.
There's definitely a part of me that wants to play that, because like I've speedrun a handful of Gundam games from like PS2 era, and it would be funny to try something else with that. I don't know. I have no experience at all with with battle operation stuff or adjacent stuff, so I don't know how well it would stand up to that kind of stress. But I do think about it once in a while.
It's a fun game for what it is, especially since it's a single player game carved out of a multiplayer game, so it has some of those elements. But you know what was interesting to me about it was it's the first like narrative Gundam game that we've had in so many years, because we used to get those all the time and Bandai just kind of gave up on those. Like, you know, I was a big fan in the PS3 generation of MS Battlefield Record 0081. Did you all ever play that one?
I played a little bit. Actually, shout outs to Tom Asimov, literally mailed me a copy of it because he just had spares.
Nice. Oh, that's awesome.
And the game was pretty cheap at one point because it was on PS3, the best. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was a fun game, and then, you know, it just, they stopped doing that kind of game, and it's like, you know, here you go, here's Versus, and here's an arcade experience, or here's an MMO-type game, and, you know, we don't do the Gundam narrative single-player games anymore, so that's kind of what drew me to Code Fury, as odd as some of it was.
Yeah, same. No, I definitely, I it's the same thoughts. I was like, oh, a single player experience. Okay, sure. I mean, I guess the only other one that we've really had recently was the SD Gundam game, right? I mean, besides the strategy games. I mean, in terms of like action stuff.
There was also like well over a decade ago, back on the PS3, From Software did a unicorn game, adapted the first three OVA episodes. I never played it, but I knew that's one of the last. Before Code Fairy, of those narrative single-player Gundam games.
We streamed that PMC.
Yeah, we streamed like
boring.
The first hour of that as dry opening. Maybe it gets really fancy later, but even as someone who's played a lot of Armored Core and other early FromSoft games, that was really dry.
Speaking of streams, if you guys want to promote the stream that you both also run as well, in addition to doing the podcast, if you want to tell the audience about your stream really quickly.
Sure. Yeah. Thank you. Besides the podcast, I've also been streaming, kind of on and off, since 2016, a lot of it being involved in Sputum. All right. You said something, Chris.
No, I didn't.
Oh, go for it.
Okay. I've been streaming on and off since 2016. A lot of it being speedrun content, a lot of, you know, other kind of older game stuff. And a lot of it, I have done a bunch of mecha games, you know, Speedrun Armored Core, Gundam games, Shogo Mobile Armor Division, you know, the PC first person shooter.
Wow.
I've taken a few of those to, that's a fun game. Yeah, I took a few of those to GDQ events, which has been fun. Like, did Shogo at TwitchCon 2019, like in front of an audience, and then. Armored Core. I also was the first Armored Core runner, and then I was on, you know, commentary for Armored Core 6 this past summer. I mean, and then of course, you know, occasionally, you know, Steven will either virtually or physically stop by, and we'll do some streams, some Giant Robot FM streaming as well.
Nice. Well, what's the URL for your stream?
Just my username, twitch.tv/PMCTrilogy. If you're watching the video, it's on the screen right now.
Oh, I didn't know you had it up. Okay, cool shit. Good stuff. Yes, it is. And if anything, I'm going to subscribe as well. Have you ever played Super Robot Wars on stream?
I have not yet. That's actually something that's going to hopefully be changing in the next few months, because we announced this just recently, but we're going to be covering the original generation OVA on the podcast in the summer. And so I'm gonna do, work it in there somewhere, some of the PS2 remake that has the fan translation patch, and probably check out some of that.
Oh, yeah, I know original that's not, like, generations. Core content, but
yeah, that's exactly right, yeah.
I can't recommend, if you have a Switch or PS3 or 4, I can't recommend Super Robot Wars T enough. It's so good, and it has one of the best rosters I've seen in a long time. If I could get a translation of Alpha, the first Alpha, I've found Alpha Gaiden translated in English, but nobody wants to translate Alpha because Alpha has Macross in it. And I played through it raw dog in Japanese, but I've never got to play it through it in English. So that's the one. That's the holy grail I love to play through. And I still have to finish T, and 30 came out not long ago. So if anything, there's a lot of SRW here in the States. I never thought I'd see the day where it finally came here, but it's definitely a fun series with all the crossover in it and whatnot. But yeah, man, thanks for
and for shameless. Sorry, for shameless self promotion, I will be making my debut on Giant Robot FM to talk about episode one of Original Generation, the animation. So watch for that in July, I believe, when it comes out.
Yo, that's awesome!
Oh, wow,
looking forward to that. It's a little outside my wheelhouse. Not that I don't know a decent amount of Super Robot Wars, just from having built all these pages on MHQ about it three times and having just absorbed all of that kind of stuff and played some of the games and watched all the anime. But it's nice to stretch my limits and not just be on something as like the Gundam guy.
No, we appreciate it. It was kind of hard to... I'm not immersed in the Super Robot Wars community, so I had to reach out to a few people. Like, who should I reach out to? Who are the knowledgeable folks about this series?
Yeah, that's the funny thing about Gundam is, like, you would think Chris... Like, two-thirds of us are not that much into Super Robot Wars, especially Chris. Not knowing that, it's a little surprising. Yeah, Solbro's best... Basically, the SME on Super Robot Wars on this show, and
the time that it takes to like create all this content for MHQ is the time I might otherwise have to play these games. So there's a trade off.
There's a magic to the series though, especially when they actually take the time to rewrite plot lines for shows that were shit. and turn them into gold like Destiny, absolutely, or figure out a way to weave the variant storylines from the different shows together is some slick stuff. So I really appreciate it. I have a lot of respect for those who translate the games officially and unofficially. Shout out to Zappaslave in the chat, who wrote that they worked on the Dreamcast version of Alpha. Some of the menus were done, a few stages, but it was never finished. Damn. I know where to find them online, but yeah, the Alpha version of Super Robot Wars on the PlayStation and the Dreamcast, for some reason, on that site are not there. If someone wants to hit me up with a DM over on Twitter, my user tag is SolbroRyu. So if you want to let me know where I can find it, please do, because I would love to go through Alpha sometime. But back to you guys.
So why don't you tell us, folks, a little bit about both the Patreon and these fanzine project that you're embarking on.
EMC, you want to hit him with the Patreon information, because you do this like two times a week.
Yeah, I guess so. So, I mean, the Patreon, has got a few, I would say, pretty classical elements. One of them is the patron-exclusive Discord, which, Chris is in. Shout out to Chris. Thank you for the support being in there. And then, the biggest thing is probably one of the two big things. One is the bonus podcast series. Twice a month, we're doing a single episode of Turn A Gundam, called a series we call Moonrace Wireless, and that's been a lot of fun. We're about 20 episodes into that, so we've been doing it for a hot minute now. If anyone wants to listen to them, the first four episodes are available for free. They're over on the main feed, so you can check it out if you like it. And you can sign up for $5 and instantly get like 15 more episodes. So that's been one of the big projects. And then besides that,
I would encourage people to
sign up for that. And yeah. I saw you had Fees on one of your Tourney episodes. We had him on the show once to talk about Tourney. That was a great conversation. That man is like such an amazing font of Tourney knowledge, but also like love and appreciation.
Yeah, absolutely.
We've had Fees on multiple episodes. Like, Fees is basically the third co-host of the Moonrace Wireless, in fact. Like, we're
recording on Sunday with them.
Yeah, we're recording Sunday with Fees. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, if Mark Simmons wasn't already, like, the Mark Simmons of Tourney Gundam, then Fees would be the Mark Simmons of Tourney Gundam.
Yeah.
Shout outs to Mark Simmons also. We had Mark Simmons on for a couple of episodes, and tremendous, just wonderful to talk to.
Oh, very fun.
He's a great guy.
Very fun, like, when we're not recording, too. But when we were introduced for the first time, he drew, like, a little doodle of PMC and I. Very, very endearing.
That is awesome.
Well, yeah, so with the Patreon, we had when we started out, our first thing was doing these extra episodes covering sort of production history in reaction to Mecha video games. And we did that for about, you know, the first 2 years of Giant Robot FM. A lot of those episodes are now available. So if you're like, hey, I want to listen to people talk about the history of the first Armored Core for 2 hours or something, you can find those episodes in the main feed. But like ultimately, it just kind of became too time consuming to do like three podcast tracks at the same time. Yeah, and we had been looking for a way for Steven to sort of repackage and you know, kind of really turn into something you can grab onto with his research for the history episodes that we do for our coverage. And so, I mean, Steven, you want to take it away? Because I feel like you're the person to talk about the zine part of the Patreon.
Yeah, so if you have never listened to a Giant Robot episode, Giant Robot FM episode before, not to toot my own horn, but I would recommend you check out our history episodes first, or at least one history episode to get like acquainted with what we do. They are very extensive, multi-hour deep dives into the production history of whatever show we're about to cover. And usually the notes on those shows are upwards of usually between 5,000 and 8,000 words long. So what I've done is I wanted to repurpose these notes into something a bit more academic with proper works cited, annotated bibliography, and images to go along with the text, to really tell a very vivid story. So that's essentially what we're doing with the zine. And we've gotten some great help from Sundown McMoon in chat, Ethan Hawker, who's a frequent guest on Giant Robot FM. He did an amazing cover, and he helped with my layout. My layout was very rudimentary, and he really made it sing. I'm really impressed. I'm looking at a copy of the proof I got in the mail. I'm very impressed with the zine, because I'm very much an amateur at this. This is my first scene I've ever made. I'm really happy with the results of it. And the feedback, we've certainly been generating interest for it.
That's outstanding. Man, is there any images of it online? If you have a link, I'll pull it up on screen.
Totally. Let's see. I think I last posted on Twitter.
I will go there. Let's
see. Yeah, on the subject of those history episodes... Shout out to the episode y'all did about Yaz. That was a really good deep dive into his career and his interests. And I would highly recommend anyone go subscribe and listen to that episode, because it's a great exploration of someone who's such a key figure in anime history.
Yeah, we had Megan D, aka Brainchild 129, on for a lot of that, because that was leading into the I think we did like reviews of the origin at OVA, and she was invaluable throughout that whole thing.
Yeah, I'm revisiting that content because you know, one thing that I started doing the last few years is, since I spent so much time working on MAHQ content, to kind of get me jazzed up in the mood, I listen to Mecha podcasts. So most often I'm alternating either between our friends Mechanista NG or your show.
Oh, I'm glad to hear that.
All right, Chris?
I'm here.
All right,
I'm still here.
All right, cool. All right.
I thought that we lost somebody.
Oh shit!
It sounded like that for a minute.
Yeah, for a second. Yeah.
So, is there anything else you want to tease that you're working on with upcoming projects or upcoming episodes. I know you just did this sleeve announcement sent your stream earlier this week at your state machine.
I think one thing we can tease
is that it's a little outside of the wheelhouse of mecha anime, but I think it's quite adjacent, is that our next main feed coverage is going to be on the movie Robot Jocks, the classic live action.
Shit! Yo,
so
I forget the line that movie ends with. Oh my god, that movie is so bad it's good. We can I forget there's a line at the end of that movie before they have the hardest handshake of all time. I said we can do something. The chat will let me know. I have to quote it before we're done. I need to close out the stream with it, but that's for another time. But yeah, that movie is ridiculous. We can live. Thank you, Dalo. We can live.
Brilliant. Yeah, so that's gonna, we're gonna get into the career of Stuart Gordon, and then go into the production history of the movie, and then of course talk about the movie itself. So it should be a very, very raucous time.
I'm tuning into that. I got to, man. I got to hear what you guys have to say about that and learn about the background of the film. So that's amazing.
Yeah, we're going to split the history coverage into two parts. I'm actually starting early next week on what's going to be like a month and a half worth of research. We're going to focus on Stuart Gordon's early career. A lot of that episode is going to be about his time as a theater director in Chicago. We're going to cover his filmography up until Robot Jocks. So we're going to talk about Reanimator, the other thing he did after Reanimator, which I haven't watched yet, Dolls. We'll talk about Honey, I Shrunk the Kids 2, which he produced. And then the follow-up episode will be focused on the production history of the film, which there's a lot of resources for me to comb through because that Blu-ray is stacked with extras. And that's when note-taking becomes very laborious, because like listening to the three separate commentary tracks and like writing down fun tidbits takes quite a bit of time.
They enjoyed that movie three times in a row. That's amazing.
I haven't seen it yet. I know
that movie since I was a kid.
Yeah.
I know the handshake you speak of. I've seen that meme, but I am completely in the dark.
Oh, I'm sorry. I ruined the ending for you.
Don't worry.
Quite. Yeah, don't worry. People have already told us about important stuff. Like, I think we already know about the chainsaw dick. So
yes, it is so bad, but it's so amazing, man. I'm legit excited for you. I can't wait to hear what you guys take us on it, man. That's fantastic.
Stuart Gordon, I mean this with all the admiration in the world, is such a pervert.
A lot of directors who are.
Yeah. He knows it.
You know, those memes about, like, you watch a show and it's like, what barely contained fetish of the writer will we be exploring this week?
Yeah, it's a good way to put it.
Yeah, yeah, the author's barely disguised fetish, a classic in literature and film.
Yeah, I'm thinking, we probably need to do a dive into more live-action mecha movies, because, there's stuff floating around out there that, like that, Unhead, or, it's just a lot of stuff out there that that we could dive into and explore and have some fun with, whether it's terrible or not.
True. I know that the only ones that we've done here on the show is G-Savior and both Pacific Rims. So, we're awful light on that subject. We need to do more of those, but there's not that many to go around, so we have to really hunt them down. But Robot Jocks is definitely on the list. It's gotta be.
Speaking of patron perks, so now patrons vote on coverage, so we make a category for like a month's or 2 months worth of coverage, and then patrons vote on what we want to cover, so everything is like of a similar caliber type of thing. So that month, the month of May was dedicated to, or will be dedicated to, live-action mecha movies. Robot Jocks won. It beat out Pacific Rim, Gunhead, and then Brave Storm, which is like a 2017 Korean live-action film.
Brave Storm? Never heard of that one.
I think it's Brave Storm. Zappa, yes. Zappa mentioned it. He's the one who voted it in.
Oh. I know we've talked about Robot Jocks so many times, but we've never even reviewed it. So
I'm already writing it down.
Yeah, there's some stuff that we've talked around a lot, but never actually like covered in depth. And that's one of those things.
Now's your time to do an in-depth dive on Wild Wild West.
Oh my God, maybe I gotta watch it again.
I've never even seen that movie.
It's a legitimately fun movie.
I know of the infamy of the spider from listening to Kevin Smith on his podcasts.
I know the infamy of that movie that, what's his name, turned it down. He turned down The Matrix to do that movie. So.
Who? Will Smith.
Yeah.
He turned down The Matrix to do that? Or was he supposed to be Morpheus?
Yes. No. Oh. No, I thought it was supposed to be Neo, but famously, yeah, he turned down.
Was he?
I think he was going to be Neo. Yeah.
Famously, he turned down The Matrix because I guess he just didn't get the concept. I mean, that's the story of his career, but you know. He didn't get the concept, did a shitty movie, and then lived to regret it when that movie took off into the stratosphere. So it is what it is.
All that I know, all he is to me is Mike Lowry. And as long as he can do that well, I'm good with that. It doesn't need to be anything else. So.
Only thing he needs a pilot is his Lambo. Go ahead, Chris. Sorry.
Neo, Sobro, any additional questions for our guests?
I've got to ask.
Before we start winding down.
Going back to the worst anime situation, two questions. Number one, have you ever seen MD Geist? And if so...
I've had Mutual's tweet about MD Geist. Mm-hmm. Shout outs to Russell Latshaw, I believe, and others.
Actually, you should watch the follow-up, MD Geist : Death Force.
Colon!
That's, yeah.
And there's that.
I still need to post some of those designs on Mecha Day. They haven't actually made it. 3 years I've been running the account. I don't think a design from MD Geist has shown up yet.
Awesome.
So do you all know the story of the MD Geist as the company spokesmecha for Central Park Media?
Yeah.
Oh, I think I've heard of that, yeah.
So, back in the day, MD Geist just appeared as this, like, little guy on the spines of VHS boxes of Central Park Media. I know because I had many of their tapes. And the whole reason for this was solely the fact that the founder and CEO of Central Park Media was absolutely obsessed with MD Geist and wanted everybody to know about it. And somehow, I guess, arranged... with the license holders to allow MD Geist to be the, and this is the actual language they use, company spokesmecha.
There you go.
Even though it's a guy in a suit. But, you know, whatever. So, you know, if y'all ever do MD Geist, as you do sometimes during your episodes, you gotta dig up, like, scans of the VHS cover and read whatever terrible description is on the back there.
Oh, totally. I always enjoy that. Sometimes the back of the box summaries are whack, and it's really fun. The dissonance it produces from a modern day like perspective is very fun.
Yeah, especially these terabad 90s things.
Oh yeah, man. My other question actually pertains to the show you just recently wrapped up, The Big O. Big O 2, I should say. Did you find it to be as engaging as part one, or did you find it to be the law of diminishing returns with that series at all?
Few things are as good as Big O season one, but I gotta say, so I was going to Big O 2 with fresh eyes. I had never seen it, and I feel like it is unfairly maligned by a lot of the fandom. I feel like the fandom hasn't seen it since 2003. A lot of people, they just have their immediate reaction to the ending and haven't really thought about it since. I like the ending. It doesn't really stick with me like, I don't know, just to pull a recent example, like End of Eva, which I rewatched in theaters. Yeah. But I think it does right by the characters. I love how it kind of gives the middle finger to fans who want answers, because that's not really the point of the show. Mm-hmm. And I think it really works like on a metatextual level, like reflecting on the process of like making a show, which I thought was cool.
Very true. And when you bring that up, it definitely gives you a new line of insight for that series. Also, I know it borrows a lot from Dark City. You know, at least in some of the concept for it, at least when the series starts to unfold its mystery and all that stuff too. And seeing Dark City and then watching that show in particular, I just found that there was commonality between the two of them. It's funny with me and Big O, when I was I used to be a draftsman back in like 97, and worked for a firm that had ISDN internet because I didn't have internet at home at the time. I used to go to Sunrise's Japanese website a lot back then. And then one day they just put on a page for the Big O, and I was mind blown seeing the ads for it. And of course, a couple years later, it would show up on Toonami with those fantastic Peter Cullen promos. I don't know if you've ever seen those, but those are incredible.
Oh, hell yeah.
Oh my god, they're amazing.
The vibes are so right on all those promos.
You're not kidding.
Especially when he's like, suit up. Yes. Again.
Again. But yeah, it's a fantastic show.
Yeah, I think
show.
For...
Oh, go ahead, Chris.
For Big O 2, it does have merit. It is weird.
It's
but
not
I think
terrible.
The thing that people hold against it the most is the digipaint transition, which, you know, you can't overlook that. Yeah. But it's not the sole defining trait of that season.
I got used to it. None of the mech battles reached the peaks of season one, because yeah. there's a real tangible quality to cell animation, which digipaint just doesn't do for me. But by episode three, the characters, for the most part, I was used to.
Yeah. I think my favorite thing about season two is that they got Alan Oppenheimer, the voice of Norman in season two. And that guy is a fantastic, legendary voice actor. He did the voice, for those who don't know, he did the voice of Skeletor and a million other characters all throughout your favorite 80s cartoons. And even now to this day, so to hear him in an anime... tripped me out, so it was really cool. But what were you gonna say, Chris? Or Neo?
No, that was it.
No.
I was just gonna add to the bit about Big O is that I feel like the even with the digipaints, like when they really leaned into it, I think there were some really impressive effects, like some of the you know, things like that were more like light brushing and like angel's wings and things coming from space, and some of the effects did really work, but a lot. But there were some really embarrassing ones as well. I think for whatever reason that in the final moments of the final episode, they like pop to like redrawn characters and digipaint on top of a cell drawn scene, and like it is just like it really plants a legacy in your brain. I'm like, oh, maybe this didn't look good, and I think it's not a fair representation of the season overall.
They do Dan dirty, though. I mean, he is off model like every other episode. His body proportions are constantly changing.
True. Yeah.
If you want to see some like really horrid like early digipaint that will make Go 2 look like a Studio Ghibli movie, have you ever heard of the series called Lost Universe?
I have not. Are there mechs in it? I could post on Mecha Day.
It's spaceship. It's more like an Outlaw Star kind of thing. So it's a very obscure anime based on these novels from the creators from the creator of The Slayers. You ever heard of that old fantasy series?
Yeah, yeah.
And there's some like light connections between the continuity of the two. But anyway, Lost Universe, it was a cheap show because it's a very early digipaint show from like 98. And it's so cheap that there's some animation that looks like hentai DVD level of drawings kind of like sliding across the screen at like a few frames per second, like randomly intercut, like in between shots. And it's like, what is going on here? Like, this is so terrible. And it's like, it's really bad. Yeah. It's like, this is... god awful looking. This is embarrassing that somebody did this.
I love it when you see like technology deployed. It's like, maybe you just shouldn't have yet. Maybe you should have held off. I recently, because you know, I've been on this BattleTech kick forever. Once in a while, I'll pull up the opening for the BattleTech animated show, which has like some. Maybe you shouldn't have drawn that in CG like that early.
Yeah, like we were talking about before the show, the CG sequence in the 1980s Golgo 13 movie, like, that shit should not have been done. Like, if you look it up on YouTube, it's like, this is really bad. And especially the fact that it's intercut with traditional animation, it's like, just do it the normal way. Like, don't do this. Yahtzee mentions in the chat, like, yes, Lost Universe was part of the early incarnation of MHQ when we called it FAHQ back in the day. So if you go far enough back in the Internet Archive, you might be able to find my reviews where I never finished the series, but it was a very weird series. And if you find some clips on YouTube, you can just see how horrid the animation is sometimes for yourself.
Oh,
it's definitely some of the worst I've seen of the digipaint era.
Man, Neo, did you have any questions that came to mind for you?
Yeah, I got a quick one.
Oh, shit.
You know, is there? we seem to have it a lot too sometimes, but I think one of you, I forget who was mentioning it, but you know, when you watch, when you hear about shows that you hadn't seen, like you've heard like the fandom talk about them, is there a lot, you know, do you often find that you're kind of off of what the fandom's saying? Like a lot of times people, like you just, I think somebody said that Big O season two, everybody was hating on it, but then you're like, you know, it wasn't that bad. I mean, do you find kind of being contrarian, not for the sake of being it, but you just are like, wait, I don't understand what all the issue is, why people are just continuously hating on stuff so much?
I'm a G Savior defender, so I will fight to the death anyone who doesn't appreciate the anyone who doesn't appreciate Mark Curran for all his glory.
and the power of bioluminescence.
Yes. I was going to say, I feel like in particular, if there's like a thing, you know, you mentioned the idea of like, you know, coming to media after the fact and saying like, why was there such an uproar over this? And I think it sounds like a thing with Big O too, that's certainly applicable. If I had to single out a piece of Gundam media that I feel is super done dirty by like just, I'm going to frankly say morons on YouTube, it would be Gundam 0079, The War for Earth, the Presto Studios made FMV game.
PMC's coming for blood today.
The fat Char game.
Char! Okay, yeah. I know it's got Char Chinsnable. I'm well aware of the red chin. But I mean, it is, I think for what it is, like all the FMV games are like that. Like yes. It is definitely representative of the period. Presto Studios made the Journeyman games, which, you know, don't have the same sort of, I think, stink attached to them. I'm not saying it's like going to knock your socks off or anything, but it is exactly what it is, which is to say it's a 90s FMV game.
Yeah.
It's definitely got all the hallmarks of it. You know, it's the Mad Dog McCree of Mobile Suit Gundam games.
All right, speaking of Gundam games, I do want to just echo that the G-Savior PS2 game does rule. It's of the Gundam speedruns I've done, it is the best one. I think it's got a pretty good shot of being on stage at a GDQ in the near future, which is pretty funny. So you might see that.
Yeah, I think about it.
You got to listen to that. A fantastic soundtrack. You got to listen to it. If you haven't, put it on.
I'll have to try it out because Bandai games back then were super bad, whether they were Dragon Ball games or I remember being exposed to Cowboy Bebop before knowing that there was an anime, like back in 98, it was an import of Bebop that came in for the PlayStation. And it's like, what is this? It's like, Cowboy Bebop, this is a wild-ass name. And then maybe 6 months down the road, I came across the tape. And it's like, wait a minute, I saw the game of this. You mean this is a show? Oh, right on. But apparently the game came out before the show over there, but the game played terrible. But the
PS1 like rail shooter thing, that's not that's kind of a bummer.
It's not the best, but to hear that G-Saviors actually have decent, have to give that a shot because it was a toss-up back then for Gundam games. I mean,
it's a very straightforward game, the G-Savior PS2 game. It's like very, you know, if you're looking for some like arcade action thrills, I think that's what it is. And the other good thing is that all the menu text is in English, and all of the voice acting is in English.
Yeah.
So you will understand the story, you'll know what you're doing. You won't have the subtitled dialogue, that's in Japanese, but you know what, whatever. You know, as long as you can listen to the game, you're fine.
Hey man, you always use Google Lens.
There you go.
You want to translate every
on the subject of, you know, media that's maligned by fans, we on this show, but also me even before that, MHQ, you know, we've been longtime defenders of Gundam X.
Yes.
And, you know, we have been in this business long enough to see like the way that the perception of that show in the West has completely changed, because I recall that show being really maligned by fans.
Oh my God.
You know, most of the time in the early aughts, because of the lack of availability of the media, had never even seen it, but they were just regurgitating things that people said on forums, like, oh, I heard it's bad because it was canceled, which, you know, always struck me as ridiculous, because it's like, well, if it's bad MSG? Just by the virtue of being canceled, what about MSG? Like,
Exactly.
Oh, yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah, you know, and there's lots of stuff that completed its run, but is, you know, not that great. So I don't understand that. But, you know, over the last, you know, 24 years that I've been doing MHQ, I've seen the perception of X really change from this, oh, it must suck because it was canceled, to like, no, this is a really solid series on its own and worthy of consideration amongst its peers in the Gundam canon. And it's a rehabilitation that I'm glad to have seen happened over the last few years.
You know, it's funny.
I remember watching it. I remember watching X the first time and, you know, seeing all that stuff on the internet. Oh, it sucks. Blah, blah, blah. And I'm just sitting there. I'm like, wait a second. How did this suck? Like, it's not perfect. It's pretty good. And I got to say, for something being canceled, it has a really kind of pretty clean ending. I mean, there's a lot of questions and, you know, Polly and all this other stuff. But, you know, but I'm like, wait a second. This doesn't make any sense. And it was funny because then we started having kind of a running joke on Gundam. And it started with the infamous second season of 00. Because, you know, second season of, you know, at first, I think 00, first season one wasn't that great. And then it was amazing because 00 season two happened. And then, you know, it was always like the next thing, something that was bad, it would then get eclipsed by the next thing that came out. Because that was the horrible one. Oh, now it's Awakening of the Trailblazer. That's shit. So 00 season two is great. You know, so it's kind of crazy and it's mind numbing, and you just get to a point, you're sitting there and you're like, oh my gosh. I mean, I don't understand why people just jump on the hive mind thing sometimes. It's really crazy because, I mean, it's, how can you really sit there and say things suck without seeing it or just watching like a 30-second trailer, which is also the thing that everybody likes to do.
That seems to be the internet move, man. But I'll say this. Recently, I've been seeing a lot of dust-ups about Double Zeta and people just going in on Double Zeta and calling it trash. And it's like, are you serious? It's like, well, you do know it gets better.
There's always a lot of discourse about Double Zeta.
Oh, my God. It gets so much better if you give it time. If you give it time, it gets better. I understand the beginning. It's rough, especially coming off of Zeta. Holy shit. It's like night and day. But then eventually you hit that groove, and it starts to coast from there on out. And it's not as good as Zeta to me, but I think it's a worthy entry. But just to see the vitriol for Double Zeta from people who have not even seen the goddamn show drives me up the wall.
Well, if you wanna stir up some shit, mm-hmm. Go on social media on Twitter or Blue Sky or whatever, yeah, and say that you think Double Zeta is better than Zeta, and then see what happens.
Oh boy!
I'm gonna get skewered.
You will get some discourse, capital D. Yes.
All so, mm-hmm. I have another question. What are you guys' thoughts about the English or not, or the Western adaptations of anime projects? You know, like we've seen Ultraman, One Piece. Yeah, not even really. Yeah, and even like Voltron and things like that. And there's kind of this blurring now, especially with the animated projects, that it's like, oh, is it truly anime? Is it not? I mean, what do you guys thought about that? I mean, me personally, it's like, as long as it's kind of a good story, I'm good with it. I don't really have to see it within the lines anymore. But I mean, how do you guys think about that stuff? Because I know that's pretty controversial online a lot of times too.
I haven't seen enough of the live action adaptations. I do appreciate. Well,
not even the live action, just even the animated ones, like Voltron. I mean, there was huge things with Voltron.
Yeah.
Just a lot of that stuff that's just, you know, it's inspired from those properties. So,
I usually appreciate the fact that they exist because of the discourse it generates. It's kind of like a film adaptation of your favorite book. Usually it's not going to live up to your memory of the novelization, but they're just, it's going to force people to reappraise the source text. And I think that is worthwhile. And sometimes those adaptations, be they live action or animated, do some really experimental things.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, in terms of like, you know, whether or not it's worth getting concerned about, whether, you know, as you bring in maybe more personnel or you're you know, producing it elsewhere, you know, is it like, and the answer, to answer that question, I mean, the thing is, categories and genres are always you know, labels derived from history or, you know, other sorts of characteristics of the work. And they're always going to be imperfect labels, right? I mean, this is,
right.
I feel like usually when I've seen this discourse, it's like, why wasn't this on my anime list or, you know, something along those lines. And, you know, it's like, I always try to remind people of this too, when, you know, if I'm discussing genres for anything, it's like, they're imperfect labels and categories. And, you know, it's like people do this all the time with like the really, really ridiculous food things. Like, is a hot dog a sandwich? Well, like, what's the history of sandwiches? You know, like, what are we, yeah. what are we really talking about here?
Yeah. Well, yeah, I was just wondering, cause I know there's been this barking now about like, oh, you know, if a Western studio does something that's animated, that's inspired by, you know, Japanese anime, is it truly anime? And it's like, it is kind of a weird thing because it's like, is now anime really coming to a point where it's becoming something that's not just in a specific, has to come from Japan, or maybe it, you know, that style, the essence, and if it comes from other places, is that acceptable? I mean, I quite honestly, with me, I honestly don't care. Like, it's like, okay, if it's kind of anime inspired, I kind of consider it anime because I'm like, they're kind of using that media. I mean, they're using that type of
the style.
Yeah, just because it's not, you know, a bunch of Japanese guys that are making it or Japanese women are making it, it's kind of the same, right? Like, it's a weird thing. It's almost like a shift that you're seeing. Like,
it's art. It's not, you know, champagne or cognac or something, right? It doesn't have to come from the anime region of Japan.
Right. Yeah, exactly.
Otherwise, it's just sparkling cartoons.
Yeah, otherwise, sparkling cartoons.
Yeah, it could come from, you know, the grapes that were transported over to California that are, you know, but it, yeah, it's, it, I mean, because you see that with that. I always put it back to the thing where sometimes people get, you know, at one point they were felt special, they felt unique because they felt something like that was their own. And then when they see it kind of go throughout, people get mad. It's like, oh, I was the first one to know about this. But yeah, it's kind of an interesting thing that I see and kind of a trend. I'm like, I'm seeing people just like going on, oh, it's not, you know, this is not true anime. It's like, yeah, but it's basically inspired by it.
I mean, if you want to get real technical, anime is a French word for animation, of course. So true anime is any project that's animated in France. But Japan took that term and ran with it and used it as well. And ironically, there were a lot of dual productions between France and Japan, especially in the 70s. But you know, they took that term and ran with it. I think today it just depends on what your intentions are. Like say with Voltron, that's based on the anime property, so you're gonna do your own spin on it and represent it. I consider it anime. It's definitely made in that same vein, made to entertain the same audiences, if not pulling new people. I even consider Avatar: The Last Airbender. At least close enough to anime that I would consider it anime, even though, of course, it's an American product. You know, I'm sure that anime studios have helped worked on it, but for the most part, I will bestow it that honor. Same thing for Castlevania. You know, it's based on the Japanese property. They're doing it in the clear anime style. So as far as I'm concerned, it's anime. As far as, you know, I'm...
Well, no, you bring up a good question, though, when it comes to like something like Voltron. It's like they could have done Voltron Legendary Defender as like with like a traditional American style animation, but they chose not to. It's more it is basically in it. I mean, if you didn't know any better, you would think that it was anime. That was just a subtitle or, dubbed over,
which leads me back to Avatar, because the same people who worked on Avatar and Korra worked on Voltron as well. And shout out to Dalo, I agree with him. Creed 3 is definitely an anime.
Interesting question. So.
In live action.
we've been going for quite a while and want to be respectful of everybody's time. Sure. So to both of our guests, any closing comments, any last plugs or mentions you want to make before we wrap up?
Steven, you got anything? I mean, that's we just wrapped our Big O2 coverage. Robot Jocks is coming. Chris will be on an episode this summer, hopefully. If you want to hear people talk about Turning Gundam, check out the Patreon stuff. The first four episodes are free. And if you want to see, I'm working on a project where I'm playing PlayStation games by order of release. I'm like 20 games in. I just finished Kingsfield Rules. So if you're interested in that, check out my stream.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, co-signed everything PMC said.
PS1 library?
Yeah, I'm just, I got time. we'll see how long it takes.
Yeah, if you've liked what we've been saying, you want to hear more of PMC and I, definitely check out anything on the free, the main feed. Recommend in particular checking out the history episodes as a nice starting point. If the idea of getting a physical fanzine in the mail has like tickled you, check out our social media presence on Blue Sky and Twitter, or just go right to our Patreon. If you sign up at the $10 level by April 10th, so that's next Wednesday, you will get a physical copy of Volume 1 mailed to you. So keep that in mind if you're interested in getting physical media such as a fanzine, which dives deep into the production history of the Big O. It's 4,000 plus words and chronicles the production of that first season.
Wow.
This fanzine is amazing.
Well, thank you.
Looks so cool. But go ahead.
Thank you for having joined us. I consider all Mecha podcasts to sort of be kindred spirits, because we're all sharing all of this knowledge and all of this commentary out of, deep love for all of these things, even if there's stuff that annoys us sometimes. But, we're all one part of this big community, just nerding out about things that we love in hopes that, other people love it the same way that we do.
Absolutely. Hell yeah, totally agree.
All right, so since Neo wasn't here at the start, I will turn it back to you to close us out.
All right, well, thank you, everybody, for joining us for episode 290 and sitting down with the guys from Giant Robot FM. And we'll be back in a few weeks with another topic. But Solbro, before we go, can you let everybody know where they can reach us?
Well, you can find all the links at MAHQ.net. That's where the magic happens, gang. Make sure to go over there, hit the favorites button, check often. There's lots of spotlights. Currently, we got a spotlight of Mobile Suit Gundam. And Zone of the Enders, man. You want to see robots with penises? Jump on in, baby. We got you. We defined the word cockpit in that show. But yes, fantastic. Planet's also classic anime. There's a spotlight going on for that there too. You can find the links to all our different websites there. Also, you can find us on youtube.com/GundamnMAHQ. Sorry for the bad connection. I'm going to be uploading the unfettered version of the video up there right after the stream. So by morning, you should be able to see that if you want to run this back. And thank you guys very much for the support. Hit the subscribe button over on YouTube, by the way, and the thumbs up on the video. And leave a comment if you'd like, man, and thank you so much. Yo, Ed asks, can we get a Braverin episode in the future? Braverin, that's currently airing, right?
The answer is yes.
Yeah, we're definitely covering that show, so no question, Ed. We're going to be on it.
Absolutely, we are covering Braverin.
We're going to blow the fuck up. I can't wait. But yes, that's what's going on, Neil. Back to you, sir.
All right. Well, thank you, everybody, for joining us for episode 290. We'll be back in a few weeks with episode 291. Talk to you guys later.
Kick you out of the house? Then why did you tell Porky you were helping Lola move? I just told him so I wouldn't have to go to the Peach Festival. You lie?